Communication. Okay, in the previous class we have discussed what the dural venous sinuses, all the dural venous sinuses, mainly the cavernous sinus. Today we will discuss the applied aspect of that, okay, and its communication, which was remaining in the previous class. So look here, this is the cavernous sinus, their structure. Okay, anteriorly and posteriorly it is interconnected via the anterior intercavernous sinus and the posterior intercavernous sinus. Okay, so there are so many tributaries coming from the meninges, the orbit, as well as the brain itself. Okay, meninges, brain, and the orbit. Now these are the communications of the cavernous sinus which we'll discuss now. So anterior and the posterior intercavernous sinus connects the right and the left cavernous sinus with each other, first one. Then comes what? It is, suppose here it was the jugular foramen place and the foramen magnum which is present here. What is this? This is the foramen magnum, and through the superior petrosal sinus, and here it is what? The straight sinus. The straight sinus, it is continued as the left transverse sinus, and this is the left superior petrosal sinus here. Again this side, this is the superior sagittal sinus which is continued as the right transverse sinus. Again this, the superior petrosal sinus which is draining here in the transverse sinus. Okay, now one more pair of sinus which is draining, that is the what? Inferior petrosal sinus, isn't it? So this is the inferior petrosal sinus. Inferior petrosal sinus, it will drain what? It will drain where? It will drain into the anterior compartment of the jugular foramen. This is the anterior compartment of the jugular foramen. This is the jugular foramen, either side. Okay, and from here there is the F-shaped sinus that is known as the sigmoid sinus. Okay, from here this is the F-shaped sinus which drains where? Again in this jugular foramen. Again in this jugular foramen, in the posterior compartment. Okay, this is the sigmoid sinus. Now again one more communication, important communication of the cavernous sinus. What it is? It is the basilar plexus of veins. Where you see the basilar plexus of veins? This basilar plexus of veins, it is situated in between the two layers of the dura mater. Where? It is situated on the clivus. Here, see, here this is the clivus. This part of is the clivus, okay, which bone? That is the occipital bone, where the pons and medulla lie. So in between the two layers of the dura mater, that is the endosteal and the meningeal layer, this basilar plexus of veins will lie, which will drain what? Which will communicate the inferior petrosal sinus. Okay, along with the basilar plexus of veins, this inferior petrosal sinus, where it will drain? It will drain through the foramen magnum, and there it will go. This is the inferior petrosal sinus, and a communicating branch, the communicating channel which communicates this inferior petrosal sinus, this is the basilar venous plexus which communicates this cavernous sinus via the foramen magnum here outside the cranial cavity through the vertebral column, isn't it? Through the vertebral column for what? It gets communicated with which venous plexus inside this vertebral column?
Internal.
Very good. Internal vertebral venous plexus. Internal vertebral venous plexus. anterior intercavernous sinus, the posterior intercavernous sinus, again the, through the basilar plexus of veins, the cavernous sinus, it is communicating with the internal vertebral venous plexus via the this basilar plexus of veins, which is present on the clivus. And it is very important because the important structure, pons and medulla, if there is thrombosis here, it is fatal. Okay, so it is very important communication of the cavernous sinus outside the radial cavity with the vertebral column. Now, what else communication is there? It communicates with which other structure? How does it communicate with the facial vein? There are two routes for the communication with the facial vein. For the facial vein, there are two routes. Okay? Two routes are there for the communication. First is via superior. Look here, the superior ophthalmic vein with the flow diagram, superior ophthalmic vein with the angular vein, communicates with the angular vein. Then the facial vein. Okay, one communication is this. Superior ophthalmic vein, then the angular vein, then the facial vein. The another communication is via, as you all have said, that is the pterygoid venous plexus. Very good. That is the pterygoid venous plexus via which root? Yes, very good. The emissary vein. Emissary vein again comes here. Emissary vein going throughout the foramen where the pterygoid plexus of veins. Pterygoid plexus of veins. Then deep facial vein and then the facial vein. Okay? So this is the route of communication, two routes of the communication with the how the cavernous sinus communicates with the facial vein. Okay? One is via the emissary vein connecting the pterygoid venous plexus via the deep facial and the facial vein. Another part the via the superior ophthalmic vein. A very important question that is asked in the exam, that is the pterygoid plexus of veins. Anyone? What is it? Where it is present?
Infratemporal fossa.
Yes, very good. The infratemporal fossa. Look here. This is the sphenoid bone. Okay? This is the sphenoid bone and in the anatomical position according to me. So, this is the pterygoid plates, a pair of pterygoid plates. This is the lateral pterygoid plate here, and here it is the medial pterygoid plate. Look here, I have colored this lateral pterygoid plate. Okay, here is the site where the pterygoid plexus of veins, small venous plexus are there. Okay, which is where it is situated in the substance around the lateral pterygoid muscle. What is lateral pterygoid muscle? It is one of the muscles of mastication. Okay? Now, this pterygoid plexus of veins, it is also known as what? It is also known as a very important question may be asked in the viva. That is the peripheral heart. This pterygoid venous plexus, it is known as also the peripheral heart. Why it is known as the peripheral heart? Pumping action. Heart means pumping action. Then how does it does the pumping action here? This pterygoid plexus of veins. And it is situated where? In the lateral pterygoid muscle. So it is to remember easily that the lateral pterygoid muscle, it is the only muscle of mastication which helps in opening the jaw. You open your jaw via the help of one of the muscles of mastication only, that is the lateral pterygoid muscle, which is assisted by other infrahyoid muscles. But the main muscle is lateral pterygoid. So when you open the jaw, open your mouth, what happens? The stagnant venous blood, isn't it? It pushed where? Towards the cavernous sinus for the drainage. By the maxillary vein and then into the cavernous sinus. That's why after sleep, when one rises after sleep, there is yawning. Why you yawn? Karke kyun aise jamai lete hain? For the purpose is to push the stagnant blood cavernous sinus. That's why it is very important. Sometimes it is asked peripheral heart. And when you will ask the peripheral heart, but short notes bhi aata hai. What are the other peripheral hearts which are present in the body? Okay? So one of here, the heart is called pterygoid plexus of veins. Related with the communication of the cavernous sinus. Now, what else? Then, with the pterygoid plexus of veins, it communicates via the three emissary veins. Passes through which foramen? 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 Okay, a very, very important question in the viva. With the communication of the cavernous sinus, with the pterygoid plexus of veins, with the help of foramen. And what are those foramen? Foramen obe, foramen lacerum, and the emissary, sphenoidal foramen. Okay? So, emissary, sphenoidal foramen. So, these are the three foramen through which it communicates, externally with the pterygoid plexus of veins. Then, another one more communication is there. Pharyngeal plexus of veins, isn't it? Pharynx, it is situated here, in the just below the cranial cavity, here it is situated below the base of the skull. Pharynx. So, how it communicates, this cavernous sinus, how it will communicate with the pharyngeal plexus? Look here. Here is the pharynx. Here it is the site of the foramen lacerum. Here it is the pterygoid canal. The pterygoid canal you can see here. Okay? Through which the nerve of the pterygoid canal and the plexus around the internal cavity artery passes. Through this canal, it passes through the this canal and it communicates with the pharyngeal plexus of veins. Okay? So, with the foramen lacerum. So, this was the communication of the cavernous sinus. Okay? Now, the applied aspect of all dural venous sinuses. What is the applied part? What is the applied aspect of these meningeal layers or the dural venous sinus which is situated in this meningeal layer? Anyone? What are the sites of the thrombosis? Which dural venous sinuses are very much prone for this thrombosis? First is? Anyone? What are the sites of thrombosis?
The paramedial sinus.
Yes, that is the superior sagittal, sinus thrombosis. Okay? Then comes what? Superior sagittal sinus thrombosis. Then comes the sigmoid sinus.
Sigmoid sinus.
Okay, sigmoid sinus thrombosis. And then the very important, the main part of this whole story, that is the cavernous sinus thrombosis, on which you are asked short notes. Okay, cavernous sinus thrombosis. So now we will read one by one what is the superior sagittal sinus and how, from where the infection reached this sinus, superior sagittal sinus. From where it will come? Anyone? Look here. I have drawn a diagram here. Okay. This is the anterior layer. This is the meningeal layer. This is the superior sagittal sinus. And here it is what? The bone. And this is the anterior layer. So this is the diploid. What is this? This is the diploid. So diploid vein, which will come here, then here it is the skull. So skull veins, which will come over here. So any infection from the skull or the diploid head itself or the nasal cavity also, because through the anterior nasal vein also communicates with the superior sagittal sinus. So it can lead to the thrombosis of this superior sagittal sinus. Okay, so what will happen if there is superior sinus, sagittal sinus thrombosis? Okay? So, what it will lead to? So, imagine there is what? I have explained in the previous lecture. There is the arachnoid granulation here. Enough. This is the arachnoid granulations. What is this arachnoid granulations are there through which the cerebrospinal fluid where it is draining inside the superior sagittal sinus. Okay. By the pores in the dura mater, that is the meningeal layer of the dura mater, and through this the cerebrospinal fluid travels towards the superior sagittal sinus for its drainage. Okay. Now what happens if there is normally what happens, this canal, this acts like a channel. This channel provides the cerebrospinal fluid from coming from the subarachnoid space to the superior sagittal sinus, because the CSF drainage is only possible when the pressure in the subarachnoid space it is higher than the superior sagittal sinus pressure. Okay, so the CSF will break in the superior sagittal sinus. Now what happens when there is embolism or there is thrombosis of the superior sagittal sinus? What it will lead to? There will be increased pressure here in the superior sagittal sinus. What it will lead to? It will exert pressure over the walls of these arachnoid villi, and they will come closer to each other, and this mechanism, this will act like a wall mechanism, so that the venous blood would not enter inside the subarachnoid space, isn't it? So increased cranial pressure will be there, because there is no pulling of the cerebrospinal fluid from the subarachnoid space to the superior sagittal sinus. And what it will lead to? It will lead to increased intracranial pressure. Okay. So normally there, when the pressure is increased here in the subarachnoid space, the CSF drains into the superior sagittal sinus. But in the case here, thrombosis is there mainly in the posterior part of the superior sagittal sinus, and you know there are the draining veins, superior sagittal veins. So what it will lead to? That will be increased intra-sagittal sinus pressure will increase, the venous pressure will increase, and it will, the pressure will be exerted over the walls of the arachnoid villi or the granulation tissue, and this capillary tubule like structure that will be closed, and it will act as a wall mechanism. What other effect? One is the increased intracranial pressure will be there, and another it is delirium. Delirium will be produced by, due to the congestion of the cerebral veins. Okay, due to the congestion of the cerebral veins, the delirium will be also present in the superior sagittal sinus thrombosis. Now look here, the sigmoid sinus thrombosis. Look here, this is the mastoid part. Okay, this is the mastoid part of which bone? Temporal bone. On the inner side there is the sigmoid sinus, S-shaped sinus, which is known as the sigmoid sinus. And this sigmoid sinus, this one, this sigmoid sinus, it is separated by this mastoid part by a very thin plate of bone. Okay, so any infection of the middle ear cavity or the mastoid, you can say the otitis media or the mastoiditis, can reach to the sigmoid sinus and cause its thrombosis. Okay, so during operation, mastoidectomy and whatever the ENT surgeon should take, that the it doesn't open the sigmoid sinus, it is not cleared here during the mastoidectomy, because it is only separated by a thin plate of bone. Okay, so sigmoid sinus thrombosis. Now come to the cavernous sinus thrombosis, the very important part of this whole lecture. The important part of the only cavernous sinus. Okay, cavernous sinus communication, it is over now. Now the cavernous sinus thrombosis. What are the effects of the cavernous sinus thrombosis?
Bulging of the iron.
Just recap to that diagram that I have drawn. Okay, here it was the sigmoid cavernous sinus, and these were the structure which is present in the lateral wall, isn't it? So these are the structure which were present in the lateral wall, above, downwards, third cranial nerve, the fourth cranial nerve, fifth and the fifth second, okay, ophthalmic and the maxillary. So these were the cranial nerves which were present in the lateral bowl of the cavernous sinus either side, okay. Now here it was the artery which I have discussed in the previous class. This artery, a thick walled artery, is also sitting here. The inferomedial aspect of this cavernous sinus. Then what happens? There are one aspect of this cavernous sinus thrombosis is the structures which are related here. They might be ruptured or the nerves, they can be paralyzed. So what are the effect of the these nerves, third, the fourth, the fifth one and the sixth? So it will produce which type of symptom? Nervous symptom. First is nervous symptom. Okay? Nervous symptom which is produced by the cavernous sinus thrombosis, because these nerves, the third, the fourth, the ophthalmic, that is the first branch of the trigeminal, and the sixth, it is sitting here, the sixth cranial nerve which is present here, just inferolateral to this internal carotid artery. This is the internal carotid artery. So these all nerves, you must be knowing that all the extraocular muscles of the eyeball, they are supplied by the third, the fourth, the sixth, isn't it? LR6, SO4, you must be knowing that lateral rectus, it is supplied by the sixth cranial nerve, and SO4, that is the superior oblique, it is supplied by the fourth cranial nerve. So this is the formula, mnemonic. So, and the third, so all the cranial, third, fourth and sixth, all together they supply the extraocular muscles of the eyeball. So what will happen if there are the damage here, that it will lead to the ophthalmoplegia. What it will lead to? The ophthalmoplegia. Paralysis of the muscles of the extra muscles of the eyeball. Okay? And this one, what the nervous symptom, what about the fifth? Ophthalmic division. What else? Nervous symptom. The pain over the forehead and the temporal area, because this is the site, mid portion and the upper eye. This is the site where they are supplied by the ophthalmic division of the trigeminal nerve. So the patient will feel severe pain here in the distribution of the ophthalmic division of the trigeminal nerve. Okay. Now come to the nervous symptom, then comes the venous symptoms. Venous symptoms. Okay. Now what are the venous symptoms here? Due to the congestion, what it will, there will be the swelling of what? Eyeball, the cornea, the root of the nose, that is congested. All the backflow of the venous blood, that will lead to the venous symptom, venous engorgement, or the orbital veins are there. So this was the cavernous sinus thrombosis effect. And one more effect, very important, that is the what fistula? Which fistula? Arteriovenous fistula, which I have discussed, when this in the head injury or the some condition where the arthromatous plaque are there, when the tunica media wall is lacking and the weak, then it will liable to be ruptured here. Okay? So these arterial blood mixes with the venous blood and it will lead to the fistula, arteriovenous fistula, and these arteriovenous communication, due to the rupture of the internal carotid artery, which is the part of the internal cavernous sinus, it will lead to pulsating exophthalmus. A very important part, pulsating exophthalmus. Exophthalmus. What do you mean by this terminology, pulsating exophthalmus? That means it is a very, this artery, each beat of heart, what happens? The eyeball recedes and comes to and fro. Okay? The eyeball comes out and again recedes back with each heartbeat, and you can get the loud systolic murmur when you will hear the with a stethoscope here. Okay? So this was the carotico-cavernal fistula or the atriovenous fistula pulsating exophthalmus in the case of head injury, which is seen in the cavernous sinus thrombosis. Okay? So So this was all about the communications and the applied aspect of what? Cavernous or the altogether the dural venous sinuses applied importance was discussed. Now, what are the functional significance of the meninges? That we must know here. Come to the functional significance of the meninges. Anyone? Functional significance, very important topic. What are the functional significance of the meninges that we have already discussed? Why it is important? Anyone? One by one. First is the dura mater. Okay, functional significance. What does it do? What is the character of this dura mater? The character of the dura mater, it is tough. Fibrous, it is very tough layer, okay, and double layer. One was the endosteal, other was the meningeal layer. So, due to toughness, what does it do? It supports the neuronal structure, that is the brain, very properly inside the cranial cavity. Okay, now, toughness nature. The other thing is, just we have discussed in the classes, right now that was the dural venous sinus. Okay, these dura mater that we are discussing here, the dura mater, this dura mater, it is through which the dural venous sinus provides a channel for a special type of arrangement of the venous drainage here inside the cranial cavity, that is known as the dural venous sinuses. So this is also providing the in between the fold of the dura mater or in between the endosteal and the meningeal layer or the in between the folds of the meningeal layer itself, these dural venous sinuses was running. So this was also. Then another thing when it comes to the what? Arachnoid matter. Okay, arachnoid matter. This is the second layer, just below the meningeal layer of the dura mater. What is that? That is the arachnoid matter, and it is tough. It is loose membrane, impermeable membrane. This is, and it is lying in between the dura mater and the pia mater. And just below there is the subarachnoid space. So what is the significance of this arachnoid matter here inside the cranial cavity? What is the functional significance of this arachnoid matter?
It forms arachnoidal granulations.
Yes, very good. Arachnoidal granulations it provides. Okay, it provides arachnoidal granulations for which I have drawn the diagram, and the cerebrospinal fluid passes through that channel to drain in the superior segmental sinus cranium. Okay, for the drainage purpose, because it is forming the arachnoid granulations. What else? What else?
Subarachnoid
space, and this cerebrospinal fluid gives what? What does it give? It gives buoyancy to the brain. Okay, and it prevents the brain from the mechanical trauma which is coming to the brain itself. So with the cerebrospinal fluid, it is very protective, which is present in the subarachnoid space. Okay, what else? A very important thing is there that you must know. It is a very important thing. Chota sa but jana chahiye. All the venous vessels, that is the artery, the vein, as well as the nerve. It is present in which layer? It is present in the subarachnoid space. Okay? It is present in this subarachnoid space. Subarachnoid space mein hi rehta hai sara structures. That is the vessels. Vessels plus nerve. That means the structures, the vessels, the artery, the vein, or the nerve which is coming to the brain or going away from the brain to the foramen. All this structure, it is present where? In which layer? That is the subarachnoid space. It provides the space for the presence of these structures there. Okay. Because then we will, next class, when we will discuss the blood supply of brain, you will see there is